You didn't even hear me. Shalom, welcome. Can... No? Oh, good, okay, good. Thank goodness I didn't say anything. Kidding. So welcome, everyone, and thank you so much for coming. So I have... Last week we did Israel and the Nations, which is in section 2, chapter 4 of the book Derech Hashem. And I had a little addendum to that, and also the one we'll be carrying on to the next few sections, which is how Providence works, which is, that's what will be the next section after that. So I know that that the Ramchal in this section of Israel and the Nations brings some concepts that are very important that can be, I guess, if you look upon them as in the natural world, especially from a Western point of view, which is very inclusive in the idea that, that everyone, especially in our modern world, that there's an equality, an innate equality within everyone. When you read the Ramchal's words and you say that, and he says very clearly there's a delineation between souls and their closeness to God. And he talks about advantages and disadvantages of one group over another. Not that you're a victim to those circumstances and that you're helpless to change your station in life, but that there are definite cases in this world and in the spiritual world where some people are disadvantaged over and some people have an advantage over others regarding their spiritual connectivity. And he also introduces a really important concept, which he's touched upon before regarding the roots and branches. But he talks about the special time after the flood, after the rebellion with the Tower of Babel, where these 70 nations, their spiritual roots, the characteristics that would comprise all the souls that enter into these into the world, that they were set, that the spiritual DNA was set. Okay, one moment. Who was that? Oh, thank you. Quick finger. Okay, so, and so this is a really important concept regarding roots and branches, and this is an imagery that continues throughout the writing of the Ramchal in regards to the angelic realm and the forces and spiritual roots and that type of thing, but also is an analogy that's carried out in scripture and in different different writings as well. And so one of the concepts was that Abraham did something that no one else had done in his time, is that he was able to raise above the level of all the others in his at his time, that through his attachment to God, through his actions, and through his faith, he was able to attach himself to Hashem spiritually at a higher level than the nations around him, than the other individuals around him. And as a result of that, then he transcended the natural laws and the general rules and regulations that govern the nations, and his descendants would enjoy this, the benefits of this close attachment, whereas the other nations would not. Their descendants would be at a lower level. But it's interesting that in regards to Abraham, he has something very special about him, that just as a tree has characteristics, if it's an apple tree, it'll produce apples. There are certain innate characteristics that allow you to identify what a tree is based upon its fruit, its branches, its leaves, the certain traits that it has. And the idea is also true in regards to spiritual roots of the souls, the roots of the souls, that there are certain traits, certain characteristics, certain attributes that help you to identify, oh, that's an apple tree, that's an orange tree. But the same is true regarding the souls of individuals that stem off the branches from these spiritual roots. Just as in a family, you carry your DNA from your ancestors, so too you have spiritual DNA that comprises your soul. And that's the best analogy that I can use. So in regards to Abraham, he's very unique in that he's the father of all converts, meaning that he took... In a very idolatrous, fallen world, was able to use all the faculties that he had to rise above his the idolatry of his family, of the nation, of the world in which he lived, and he was able to perceive God at a very different level. And as a result of this faith and trust and attachment, then he becomes this lone voice, and his descendants begin, he begins a long chain of people who share characteristics and attributes such as his spiritually. And so the idea that the Ramchal says that there's Israel and there's everyone else is really important, meaning that in regards to the service of Hashem, there are certain attributes that God looks for in those that are that attach to him, that come to him at a very high level. And the analogy that is used throughout Scripture all the time is that between a husband and a bride. And in regards to selecting a bride, God makes it very clear that he's pretty certain the image of what his bride is supposed to be, who he wants to choose as his beloved, is pretty clear. He has an idea. And so part of the mechanism of Torah is transforming ourselves into that image so we become an acceptable and yeah, sure, there is certain generational blessings, but there are also, Christy, we'll open up the discussion in a few minutes for questions and answers, okay? Please stick around. So there is an idea that when there is blessings that are bestowed upon each generation based upon the your forebears, that you have certain benefits and rewards that you have, you can partake of, that you can enjoy, which is wealth or privilege or status that have nothing to do with your own merit, but simply by the fact that you were born into a particular family in a particular time. There are advantages that we have in the modern world that people didn't have 100 years ago regarding medicine, and there are advantages that we have in the Western world and in the first world nations that the third world doesn't have based upon the disadvantages that they have. So everyone's circumstances are different in the physical world, and the same is true spiritually as well. But he makes a point to say that in the world to come, the bride is the bride, that there's this special relationship between Israel and Hashem, and all the nations are included, but at a different level. And so there's a little commentary regarding that I wanted to read very quickly before we get into and back into Derech Hashem, just to shed a little bit on light of, okay, if Israel has this unique relationship, how does one obtain this? Is it by birth only, or what is the deal? So it is by birth, but the Ramchal makes a very important statement saying that you have the ability, whereas before the roots could change characteristics, or your attributes could change before the flood, before the Tower of Babel, when the 70 nations became set and those attributes were set, then the only mobility that one had was the branches. You could move yourself from one tree and attach yourself to another by your own actions, by your choice. And so see if I can find, I'm sorry, I lost my marker here. And so as a result of this special, unique relationship, what do we have to do? And this is the best definition that I could have found yet regarding this. And this is, again, an addendum to the Israel and the Nations. It says here, so what's the difference between the quote-unquote the soul of a Gentile and the soul of a Jew? This is a question set up by a commentary. It says, a Jew is defined as a person who is prepared to give his life for the sake of God. In this sense, holiness in general may be defined as whatever is nullified before the Almighty. Blessed is he. The fundamental difference between holiness and the evil realm is not an external phenomenon, but an inner kernel from which everything comes and to which everything returns. When this kernel is solely self-oriented, then the beginning of a human act, no matter what it may be, is for the sake of the self, so that the act belongs to the evil realm. When a person is self-centered, even if he gives charity, acts kindly, or is involved in holy deeds, his actions only enhance his ego and more generally magnify the impurity. So, and I'll begin in the next section very quickly. The important thing is, if you look at the attributes, what were the characteristics that set Abraham apart from his generation that caused Hashem to give him such a favored position in his descendants as well? And you look, and it was this ability, even at a young age, till he looked at the world and he saw, using reason and his intellect and everything that he had in him, in his being, to connect to Hashem, not for his own sake, not for the rewards that he have. The best act, the most charitable giving act a person can do with the wrong orientation, meaning that it's not to serve Hashem, it's to serve yourself, that you can even, you know, heaven forbid, be able to keep the ordinances of Torah and to act out the motions of a life that's trying to connect to Hashem, that your motivation above all, your intent above everything else, is what sets you apart. And as a result of this intent, Abraham was the first person in his generation to basically take his devotion and his actions and seek out this true creator of the world, the one true God. And, you know, the different midrashim, different teachings regarding his life show that he took extraordinary circumstances and risks in his own life just to do that. He destroyed his father's idols and could have incurred great punishment from his father, not for the sake of him, of anger or any lofty or high goal, but it was literally to connect himself to God and to connect his family. So his intent was what set him apart. And so how does one remove yourself from one branch to another? Well, when your intent is in the wrong place, your heart, your motivation is in the incorrect place, then that is how you move from one branch, one tree to the other. And so that was just a little addendum that I wanted to give. So there's a little bit more I'll get into at the end, but I don't want to get too far off the path of where we were. Okay, go ahead. I'll open the mic up for questions.
You were talking about the ego, and I was just wondering, do you believe that it's possible to do any kind of mitzvah? I don't know if so every any kind, because that when we're thinking about Hashem or the Almighty, you know, I think it's probably easier when this is mitzvahs dealing from man to man that your ego can kind of get in there. But do you think it's possible that there's not any kind of trace of ego that comes up when you're doing these mitzvahs? Going to release the mic.
That's a very important question, and the point in the honest answer is to the extent that you're able to do that, the extent that you're able to put aside your ego, your selfishness, your propensity to be drawn to physical pleasures and the physical world, and also protect yourself and your own interests, and to lay them aside and serve Hashem, regardless of where it takes you and what the cost truly is, that is the level at which you can attach to Hashem. And the idea is, and that you're going to see in the book, in the Ramchal, that he shows you the high mark, that the perfect model. And when you reach that really high level that the Ramchal describes, it's called the level of the Zadik, that most, this righteous individual who's able to nullify themselves to such an extent that every action, every intent, everything that they do is directed with full consciousness and devotion to Hashem, that everything they do without turning aside. Now that state is for the majority of us, that state is absolutely an impossible level at which to live. And that the reality for most of us is that the pursuits of the mundane world, which are necessary as a result of our fallen world, that we don't live off of miracles. We live off the sweat and the toil of our own work. And as a result of that, then it's very easy in this world to be drawn into mundane things without the intent to rectify them or to serve God with them. That it's easy to be at work. And for myself, I find, you can be working for a couple of hours and, oh my gosh, you realize that you hadn't been thinking about God or you hadn't been doing other things, that you've been basically caught up so much that spirituality is out the window. And so that is the fall of the world. But the important thing is the absolute pursuit to the greatest extent that one is able to turn their heart and devotion towards God. And Abraham, and you see Abraham doing that in a way that is it is pretty amazing. He breaks the idols. His very life is threatened. He's hidden away. These are all midrashim regarding him. That he's hidden away in a cave. That his life suffers, but still his devotion is towards God, and he tries at every point he can to serve Hashem. And so, as a result of his faithfulness, and you look and you see that Scripture is full of people that do. The story of of the patriarchs and of the kings of Israel and different, even different prophets, that they don't necessarily always maintain that 100% focus. So you see even in these great men that their ego gets in the way and they do fall. But that's where, and even that has a purpose, even that has a function and a very important role. And there are mechanisms that the Ramchal is going to be introducing. Again, he talked about punishment reward in earlier chapters, and he's going to get back into that as well. Regarding these mechanisms that God has placed in the world in order for this overarching goal of creation, which is that all the maximum number of people, the maximum number of souls in creation find their way into the world to come in the best shape possible, to put it so succinctly. So there's mechanisms in this world for that to happen. That if you aren't able, if you do make a mistake, if you fall into this sin and spiritual blindness in this world and you get sucked into the physicality, that there are mechanisms that God has placed within creation to wake you up, to allow you to repent, to do teshuva, and ways that God has placed in creation to cause your actions to be dealt with in such a way that you can enter into the world to come. And so we're going to be getting into Chapter 5, which is how providence works. And we're getting into some interesting 5 and 6 and 7. So this idea of providence is, again, this is the system that God has put in place to basically make his will manifest in our world. And so it's a very important concept, and it entails a lot of Ramchal's book. So we'll be continuing on in 5. Oh, thank you. So, for those who have the same book as I do, it's page 147. It says, until now, we have been discussing the rules of providence. We will now discuss how it works. In general, when we speak of God's providence, we are discussing two things. One involves God's perception, and the other his influence. With regard to God's perception, we are already aware that he knows everything. It is absolutely impossible that he be ignorant of anything, either in the past, present, or future. Everything that was or will be was foreseen by God from the beginning of time, and nothing was hidden from him. Everything that exists is revealed and known to him in its every aspect. Absolutely nothing is concealed from God, and his knowledge is not bound by time. We say that God scrutinizes things, however, when he judges or issues a decree regarding them. This is then bounded by the time during which he wishes to act upon these things. This concept will be discussed further in the next chapter. When we speak of God's influence, we are speaking of the system and order that he desired to make use of in translating his will into action. God arranged all created things in a system of steps and sequences, this being the system that he desired. Just as he desired that this sequence exist in the nature of things, he likewise willed that it exist in their maintenance and function. Through this system, all details of existence are sustained and influenced by God as he desires. This is true of every process and relationship. So this gets us in the quandary. Shalom. This gets us into that quandary of, we know that we're given a choice, but yet Hashem knows all things. Nothing is hidden from God. Nothing can be unknown to Him by Hashem's very nature. Everything in this physical world, every possibility, everything that has and will be, is completely known without any surprises or shocks to Hashem. He knows what's going to happen. Yet in the same time, we have the ability to truly choose. And go ahead. In a moment, I'm just gonna finish up the thought and we'll do questions. So you get the idea of many paths are before us, that we have the option, the ability to choose many actions. Now, based upon our previous choices, there's a fair amount of predictability in where we will go. And this comes into this really important concept of, while all things are known to Hashem and all paths, all possible choices, all possible options are always known to Hashem, just like the raindrop that starts at the top of a window and works its way down, you know that it's going to hit the bottom, but there are various traces, pathways that it can take. The wind could shift it, a minor flaw in the glass could shift its path one way or the other. That being said, this is one of those really high points of discussion, that there comes a point where you have to say, well, we can try to understand things as best we can. There is an unknowable aspect to this as well. But the idea is that based upon your actions, your previous actions, you can predict a fair amount of certainty what a person will do. That being said, if it were so easy, then we would be robots. The point is, we don't always act in predictable patterns. Sometimes we choose things, we make choices, we react in such a way that is contrary to where we are or where we could be. If that weren't true, if that weren't possible, then there would be no room for repentance, teshuvah, and there would be no ability to fall away from our attachment to God. So it's this unpredictability, this ability to receive what Hashem has given us in the world, to be receptacles, but also that there, he talked about determinate influences earlier in his book and indeterminate influences, and one of the unpredictable wild cards in creation is mankind. And our ability to influence the spiritual world and the physical world is unparalleled in any created being. And so while everything is known to Hashem, and while everything, every choice and every option and every action is not hidden, we still do have the real option of choice. And what that truly entails is the point of discussion on providence. That he's saying is that you have, for the most of us, for most people, we live at this very general rule of law spiritually. That most of us are in a rut. That the large portion of mankind doesn't do that unpredictable thing. They don't deviate from the path that's before them. Most people live in a certain area. Their job, their choices are influenced by their socioeconomic background, how much money their parents had, the options, availability of whether or not they go to college. Those type of things are pretty much set. That if you look, a fair amount of people continue on the same pathway as their is their parents, and generally don't move. I say there's not a lot of mobility in regarding people's choices. That's not true. If that weren't true, then I was reading a text. So we have, most of us will fall into this mundane area. He's saying there are people, there are times in individuals' lives where we rise above that general area, and we make choices that are outside of this predictable sequence of events. And that's very rare for us to do that, and when it does, and we have this high attachment. So how does God work this into the world? That he has his own influence. So how does he do that? He arranges things. We talk about in previous chapters that Every nuance of our life is orchestrated by God. Every aspect of our life is there for our greatest good if we make that choice. But until we make that choice, then it's just circumstances. It's just the set of circumstances to which we're born into. The point is you have to make the conscious choice to use those circumstances in the service of God. When you make that choice, now there becomes an intense focus upon you, that you've made a connection to God. Now focuses attention back upon you to orchestrate, to carry out the choices that you've made. And the idea is that either for good or bad, when you choose to sin, when you choose to go against the will of God, then your circumstances will be orchestrated to keep you on the path of evil, basically, because you made that choice. You made a conscious awareness. You made conscious choice. You made it with full awareness to continue to make a choice of evil, and you'll continue on that path. The idea is that Hashem will even send angels to keep you on the path that you chose to go. And the same is true regarding the path of good, of serving Hashem and cleaving to Him, that He'll give you the assistance necessary to stay on that path. So the influences are constantly being, the circumstances of our life is constantly being acted upon by God when we make those choices to go from the mundane to either evil or good. And so God doesn't act directly in the world. He acts through mediators, through a series of steps. And just like you, if you were to plug in your MP3 player or your vacuum cleaner directly into the feed coming out of the power plant, you blow its circuitry. And so the same is true. There's an idea that there's a restriction. As things come down into the world, it's restricted. It's held back even further by the forces, by the angelic realm. And that is how the spiritual being that we call God is able to create physical existence and create entities that have consciousness and awareness apart from, I don't want to say apart from God, but there's this ability to view yourself as a being and not as this general whole of the universe. And so these influences come down in steps, and as a result of this, he gets into the next area. Says, when God thus influences an angel, who in turn influences another angel on a lower level, this continues step by step until the final angel acts upon a physical thing. This can either sustain this thing or bring about something new, all according to the decree ultimately emanating from God. The sustenance of everything that exists on every level, however, ultimately emanates only from God. It is God's power that sustains all created things, as well as their order, each one in its particular aspect. Things that occur in the physical world, however, must be brought about through a system of entities and their relationship discussed earlier. This, in turn, must follow the sequences we have mentioned before. So he says that what we call nature, what we call rules of nature, gravity and electromagnetism and all these different forces that we're able to describe mathematically through physics and through experimentation, it's all basically a cloak. It's the clothing hiding the reality of the world. And the reality of the world is the reality of the world is the physical world is not reality. The reality of the world is that the world as it exists is truly emanating from a being who has no physicality. That the physical world as we perceive it, as we understand it, as we see, is actually constantly being renewed every moment of every second, and that the true agents are not the gravity and electromagnetism and all these different forces that bring us our solid world and cause a pen to fall, but they're actually spiritual entities behind that. But the pen I hold in my hand, its penness, its form, doesn't come from the laws of nature. The laws of nature are like the clothing of the real world. Behind, if you were able to peel back that clothing of nature, you would see that the true plumbing, the true system of the world is spiritual. And so this is a really, really important concept. If you look at the Torah, you'll see that the way you deal and interact in the physical world is very important, and it constitutes a large part of the commandments. And failure to interact in the physical world in the proper way brings about spiritual consequences. So when you eat something that's forbidden, when you misuse an object, when you use an object in an improper time, then you're not affecting the physicality of this object. You know, something like gold used in the temple is just gold. How can it be holy? How can it be unholy? How can an object become impure? And then you see that it's not the physical pure impurity. It's not dirty, like it's covered in germs. It's the spiritual being. It's the spiritual influence behind it, causing it to come into physicality that is affected by our actions. And so through our interactions in the physical world, we can take and influence these spiritual forces in ways we may not even be able to perceive and understand. And so God, who made the universe, who created these beings, these entities that cause our reality to come into play, knows certain actions can cause some detrimental consequences. Like a two-year-old who's playing with a knife around an electrical outlet may not understand the principles of electricity, may not know when you what an electrical shock is. We do, and so we take and safeguard our home against others. And same is true regarding the Torah. There are principles that are in play that can do some serious damage, not only to our own souls, but to the physical world as well. And so God has implemented safeguards for us. One moment, please. Thank you. Sorry, I'm just saying a bit. Well, there is within us, I guess if you look within, it's in the physical world, there's an innate fear of unknown things that is placed within the animal kingdom. And, you know, we have a nefesh, we share attributes of the animal world as well, so there's a certain fear that's been bred within us. And there's a certain level of revelation. The idea is that, you know, just because the Torah was given and it's a very specific revelation of who God is, it's a very direct revelation of who God is in regards to what has been revealed in this world, that there is the idea in this night of general providence that there is a general revelation of who Hashem is that exists within this culture and human behavior. There are certain attributes. We are made in the image of God. We have attributes that God has placed within us that mirror attributes within Hashem's very nature. So we all have within ourselves, within our organized groups of countries and communities, we have attributes that reflect the attributes of Hashem amongst mankind. Yeah, that there is a general revelation, there's a general providence, that God just doesn't turn a blind side to. So He is involved, but the influence in regards to Israel, in regards to those people who make a conscious decision to serve God, to cleave to their Creator, that He interacts with them more directly. The difference is between seeing the king and seeing an emissary of the king. Whereas most people, the nations are dealt with in such a way that they don't interact directly with the king. They're sent, they have a system of emissaries that act upon them. And so it's at what level you would like to have accessibility to God. And so there is general revelation, and you can see that in the Midrash regarding Abraham and how he's able to connect to God that are innate within humankind, and using the attributes of nature, he was able to connect to God. He didn't have, at 3 years old, he didn't have this, you know, he wasn't sitting reading the Torah scroll. He was looking at in nature, and he was looking at his own attributes and reality and examining them in such a way that he was able to find God in this general revelation of the world. So we have the idea that all the physical things that we see, grass, trees, they all have an angelic force behind them. They all have the forces, and they all ultimately attach to Hashem, that nothing in this world exists without Hashem, and that without Hashem, everything in this world would cease to exist. And so the system in which God's ratzon, His will, is brought about into reality is through these emissaries, through the angelic and the forces and all of these things, which translates into our existence in the physical world. Continuing on in section 4. God created a directing angel over everything that exists in the physical world. He likewise gave each of these angels such a nature that it should remain at its post and sustain what is placed under its hand. It cannot be removed from its post except through a system set up by God. Thus, for example, there is a directing angel associated with trees, and its task is to strive to sustain these trees. When a decree is issued by God, however, the directing angel of the wind may be strengthened to the extent required by this decree. The angel of trees can then be pushed aside, and some of his trees torn up by the wind. With this general concept, however, there are many levels and details. There are angels assigned to oversee the laws of nature and strengthen the various aspects and processes of the physical world. Above them are the angels involved in carrying out decrees concerning reward and punishment, and according to such decrees, these can prevent the angels of nature from functioning. All of this involves many details according to God's unfathomable hidden ways. And there, I know there's specific commands when Israel's go out to war that they can't cut down the fruit trees. And so you see that in regards to how God's will is translated into our world, that it starts very general and it becomes more specific, more specific, more specific. So it continues to be restricted down till you get the angels that are over general concepts and the angels that are over specific concepts to the angels that are over specific things. And so when something happens in the physical world, it by necessity has to have a spiritual influence directing it. And that these angels can't act according to their own will, that they act according and only to the will of God, that where they're placed, they stay. Their very nature is they're not immutable except through certain spiritual principles, certain concepts that can change them. And so you can see that you see various commands regarding how, you know, when you're out sowing the field, when you go out to war, how the land is to be dealt with, specific things you can or can't do. The Shemitah is a good one. Every 7 years you couldn't plant your fields. And so there's a lot of commandments regarding the land. And while they may have good, you know, good agricultural sense, and they may make some good, make for better, you know, more fruitful harvest, and there may be some quote-unquote physical benefits to them, there's also a really important spiritual concept behind them as well. And it's for the Shemitah and other commandments that they disregarded, that they were punished as well. So you can see that, you know, how you interact in the physical world influence spiritual entities, and they in turn act upon them. So part of the reward and punishment of not keeping the Torah or keeping the Torah would be physical bountiful harvest, the rain in its proper time. So these spiritual influences through Israel's actions could be working for them or against them based upon how they interacted with them. So I'll open up the room for questions here before we get on to the next section.
I was wondering about the, you know, the angels, like, let's say, okay, in nature, about holding the trees or something, and unless there is a decree that comes from God to... maybe a tornado is supposed to come through, that sort of thing. Now, about people, and I know that there are angels. I know we have angels, okay, because I've had experience with angels several times, and also even as a young child, and I, you know, that... So I do know that they exist, but when you look at... The question it brings up to me is, well, but you do have children that die from accidents and all this kind of stuff. So where is there, you know, is there angel? Does it have anything to do with being chosen? That since he does know, he knows you're going to come to him and that sort of thing. Now I know that's kind of what is that? I don't know who has that doctrine, but anyway, I'm just wondering why some do, or you know, some children are helped, some are not, and that sort of thing. And there was something I wanted to tie that together with. I should have written it down. Anyway, I guess that's the question right now. I know that we have to have Torah to. Here's another one too. So when we follow Torah, then they have to. It has to be specific instructions for us in every part of our life. Otherwise, then we can't really follow it to where we're knowing what we're supposed to do or not supposed to do. Okay, I'm going to release the mic.
There's two things. One, regarding like a specific individual, one of the really important principles is that ultimately the nuances of reward and punishment, what happens to an individual, there's so many various influences that we can't look at any individual, including ourselves, with absolute certainty and say, well, they were taken for such and such a reason. But there's an important concept in the regarding providence that you really want to be at this. It's a precarious position you'd like to be at, but it's also, a frightening place as well, is when you're under the specific, when the Lord of all the world, the master and the creator of our reality is specifically has his intent upon you. That's a wonderful, beautiful place to be at. But also, to be scrutinized by the King of Kings can be a very fearful, frightening place to be. So the idea is that you want to be at this higher level where you're interacting directly with the King. But like all kings, and it's hard for me, you know, we grew up in this democracy where we don't really understand the total absolute power that a king can have over his subjects. But the truth is that Hashem has absolute power and dominion over his creation. And to be at this level, we're directly interrelating to the highest level we can with the King of Kings, with the master of our soul, that it has its benefits, it has its rewards. That being said, there's a level of just this general providence, meaning that the rules that most of the world lives in, that they fall into the system of what happens to them, not specifically because God has intended that individual get that certain action, but like a ship that's being tossed about by the waves, it's being acted upon by the quote-unquote natural world, that there's no specific intent for this individual, because they're living at this very mundane level. Without consciously serving our God, we allow ourselves to fall down to this level. So the idea is that the more connectivity that an individual has and that humanity has with God, that the more directly influenced their life will be by Hashem himself, that they won't be subject to the travails and the consequences of the natural world, that they'll actually be at a higher level where the nuances of their life are constantly being redirected by God because his intent is upon them and their intent is upon them and him. The idea is that there comes a point where the deficiency and the sinfulness and the fallenness of this world can absolutely block out the light of Hashem, that the world can be to such an extent that we basically cut Hashem out of the equation and evil abounds to the extent that and it's coming up in the I think two sections that there are there's the influence of evil in the world to such an extent that evil overwhelms all of humanity, all of creation. Or that humanity, through its intent and focus upon God, through individuals correcting themselves and serving Hashem, that a greater amount of God's light is able to enter in this world, and it benefits everybody. The idea is that we're all connected. We're all interconnected. Our interconnectivity is so great that it's really hard to sort out one individual's actions because we have an effect on everyone else. And that principle is really important in the Torah, that one individual Jew can cause a great amount of evil to fall on the community. And so we are all interconnected. And he uses this principle earlier in the book to say, well, if one individual can sin or a group of individuals can sin and cause evil to fall, we know that Hashem loves us and his desire is towards chesed, towards mercy and loving kindness and forgiveness. Then when people turn and serve him, then how much greater will his blessings be and his light be? But that being said, when a majority of humankind is only serving themselves, is fallen into this physical world, then evil abounds in consequences. Yeah, it's as much as being, I mean, look at the generations that people were born into and how much it interacted upon what happened to you as an individual. And nothing you did. It's just you just had the good or bad fortune to be born at a specific time. And so you really have this motivation because this general providence exists, and you may not escape. You really have this motivation to serve Hashem at a higher level, to escape the general providence, to escape the general rules that govern the world mostly. And so by serving our Creator, it's not that you're serving God so everything good will happen to you. It's you're serving God, and now His intent and His focus is more upon you as an individual than just as a whole group. And this is what Ramchal is trying to lay out in the previous chapter, is that you have two groups in the world. One group is searching to attach to Hashem directly, and his direct focus is on them. And then you have everyone else who's just living their life, following the pathway that's predictable, and whether it be how wealthy they are, how the advantages or the disadvantages that they have. Regardless, they're just following that predictable pathway that's put in front of them. And so our hope and our purpose for creation, for being created, is to cleave to our Creator, to rise above that. And not saying that we ourselves won't fall back into that common lower level, and Israel does all the time. It's called exile. When Israel falls out of this specific connection to God down into this lower degraded state called exile, it serves a purpose too. But we can do that. We can have that cycle as individuals as well. We can go from connectivity to exile very quickly based upon our own actions. Not that we've been booted out and that we're never going to be able to reconnect with Hashem, God willing, but we do as individuals. A lot of us follow the same pattern. You look at Israel as a whole. When you serve, when you seek to serve Hashem and you fall away, then you go into this system where that direct connectivity to God is removed or cut off based upon your own actions, and so you fall into this general storm of the world. And when you can do something that's amazing, that is the most powerful act in creation, and that's called teshuvah. So, and that's repentance and returning back to to Hashem. So continue reading here in 5. I don't know if I read 5 or not. No, I did not. So God Himself oversees all things above and below, roots and branches. He constantly takes into account the ultimate general, and all creation revolves around this point. This general concept then affects each individual according to his particular readiness. On the basis of this, it is decided whether he should be drawn close to God or cast away, and whether he be purified by suffering or left alone. Each and every individual is dealt with according to what he deserves, in such a manner as to advance the perfection of creation as a whole. So the question comes into being, do you want to be a pawn being used by God, not because you choose to be, but just by the very actions of you exist? Or do you want to be a conscious being directing your talents, your purpose, your attributes in the service of Hashem to be acted upon directly for the purpose of creation? Now, you'll be used either way, but the point is we are created with the intellect that was meant to create, to connect to our Creator. And when we don't use that faculty of reason and being, then we just become pawns. We don't become, we'll be used, but not because of our choice. So it's almost like if you sin, if you break that connectivity, and I'll read it. There's another section at the end I'll read in this other book I was reading from, that you, not that you lose the ability to choose, but the perception and the reality is that you're not making choices at all. You're being used, but you're being used in the incorrect way. That you're not being used because of your choices. You're being used in spite of where you are. And that the overall plan of God's purpose for creation will come about. Now, whether you're going to be an active participant helping to bring about that goal, or you're just going to be a pawn that's used in spite of yourself, is a really important difference. I don't know if that... So I'll continue on here. When he wills, God can change the order of creation at any time. He can bring about various miracles and wonders as he desires and deems beneficial for creation according to the time and circumstances. This might seem to contradict what our sages teach us when they say, in the cases where miracles occurred, God made specific conditions with all of creation. This statement, however, does not mean that in cases where God did not make such conditions, he can no longer change things. This is not the case, for God can definitely change things as completely as he wishes at any time he pleases. What our sages are teaching us is that at the time of creation, God showed and informed the roots of all created things of their true essence and nature, as well as their purpose, the purpose for which they were created. He furthermore showed these roots everything that they were destined to bring about throughout history, as well as their ultimate destiny. They realized and knew that everything was directed towards a genuinely good purpose, and therefore rejoiced and were satisfied. This is what our sages meant when they also taught everything in creation was first asked if it wanted to be created and agreed. When God informed these roots of their concept, nature, and ultimate effects, he also showed them that their fulfillment would require them to be involved in miracles at specific times. These might be for the sake of the Jews as a whole or for a particular righteous individual. I'll continue reading a little bit here. All this concerns the highest roots, and following all this, the necessary sequence was then set into motion. Everything appropriate to these roots was placed in the physical world, and directing angels were set over these things to sustain them, according to the laws of nature. Then, when God willed it, it was decreed that these directing angels should suspend their function and that the natural order be changed according to that decree. A decree can be issued in many different ways. Thus, for example, it can be issued like a royal order or in a manner of a tirade of an angry tyrant. We find an example of the latter with respect to the splitting of the Red Sea. It is written in Psalm 106:9, God raged at the Red Sea and it became dry land. All this likewise depends upon time and circumstances. So we see that the world is predictable. The world, you know, if you drop a cannonball from a tower, it will hit the ground. If you do certain actions, then there's predictability in the world. The point of this is, though, God, who created this system, who put in effect all of this predictability, also is able at any time to completely suspend what we call the rules of nature and act contrary. And when this has happened, when nature doesn't react in a predictable way, this is what we call a miracle. And so that's the prerogative of the king. And so he's saying is, now miracles aren't common, ordinary, everyday occurrences. If they were, they wouldn't be miraculous. That the world, for the most part, is absolutely, it's predictable. We can describe it mathematically. We can describe it through principles. And if it weren't predictable, this would be impossible. But there are times, there are places that the rules of nature are peeled back and suspended, and we have the miraculous. And the greatest example of this would be at the time of the Exodus, when they witnessed miracles and through the Exodus, through the desert to the land where they had the miracles of the manna and the pillar of fire and the cloud. So you can see that in specific times for specific reasons that the rules of nature are suspended and turned on their head and the miraculous does occur. But even this was built into creation. Even the ability and the possibility of the miraculous is built into the system and order of creation. It's another pathway that nature can take. So he's saying that everything that is in the world that is needed, whether it be miraculous or mundane, whether it be holy or impure, everything that was needed is placed within creation by God, and it serves a function, it serves a purpose. And even the miraculous is built into this system. So all of these things are built not to wow and awe and amaze us, but the everything, whether it's evil or good, repentance or sin, all of these things are used, these ideas, these concepts are used by God to bring about his ultimate purpose, and that is to bestow his love upon his creation. And by doing that, he has to get mankind and humanity to a point where we are able to cleave to our Creator and connect to him. And so these systems of providence is the primary system through which God brings about this desire, this will for his creation. Next week we will be getting into, let me see here. I don't know if we'll get into, we could get into the system of providence a little bit. I don't know if anybody has any questions or comments. I'll open the room here for that for just a moment.
So then would it be fair to say that everything that we go through, and this might not be right either, but is to get us back on track to Torah. And I think we mostly know if we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing, but let's say things in the past or whatever that that what about this where he forgives our transgression and doesn't and throws it into the sea of forgetfulness, or all this, doesn't look at it anymore, acts like it's, so what is that true, or is that or is it not true, and we do have to pay for everything that we do somewhere down the line? And I don't know what, I guess that's my question.
We'll actually be getting into Hasetan in the next coming sections, but the I guess you could say that the circumstances, if you choose to rebel against the will of God, if you choose to act against Hashem's will, then you do set yourself on a path that's called sin, and you have consequences and reactions and forces. So, but when you choose to turn away from your sin to repent those things into good, but they only become that way after you've made that conscious choice. They're the literal agents of your destruction if you continue to choose the path of sin. But they also, in a moment, can be transformed into holiness based upon your actions. I'll read a section out of the book that describes that was concept I'm trying to say. So he's talking about a person who's sinful in this section. He says a commentary, when the Lord awakened one out of sleep, meaning that a person who had been living and who had been sinning is now has this, the Hashem has interacted in their life, intervened in such a way to give them a moment of enlightenment to cause them to repent if they choose to. So on such an occasion, the sinner is inspired to withstand the test of faith in God without any reasoning or knowledge or intelligence that may be comprehended by him. At this moment, when the person does real teshuvah, he is prepared to die for the sake of something whose existence every element of his rational mind denies. So a lot of times we'll find ourselves in these areas where rationality doesn't describe the emotions and the feelings and the drawing and the desires and the yearning that we feel. This is Hashem acting upon our souls, that we are physical creatures that have rational minds, and we live in a world that is pretty predictable, but our true essence and our connectivity to God is through our soul. And sometimes God acts upon our soul, and our soul is able to scream out loud enough that our physical, that we actually can feel that. And that's the pollution of this world that keeps that connectivity from really happening too often. But when it does, it can be very powerful. So it says here, and this person, the sinner who does repent, is able to prevail over the uncleanness and temptations of this world, whether it is permitted or prohibited to which he had been accustomed. Not only does he force himself to overcome his desires, he goes even further, begins to even despise them, as he transforms his personal traits into holiness, and to choose God as his portion and his lot, yielding to him his soul, even to the point of death, in order to sanctify his name. For even though these unclean forces had prevailed over him all of his life, and he was impotent against them, as the rabbis have said, the wicked are under the control of their heart. So the Ramchal talks about your choice is literally cutting you off, and you falling down to this level where you're not even really making a true choice. And this is a paragraph I would like to read that really describes that very well. So the wicked person cannot control the thoughts and feelings of his heart, and so he stands beyond the bounds of free will. This is not to say that, in principle, he has been stripped of the ability to choose freely, but that, practically speaking, he is no longer able to make an informed choice. He is caught within certain modes of living and thought. He no longer possesses the motivation to change his life. He is not able to, nor does he have any desire to, make decisions that will result in any actual change. Instead, he slips steadily down a slope that, in practical terms, he will not be able to climb again. Exactly, and sin in the physical world is this really dangerous place where we live. It's a very precarious place because it's the exact opposite essence of our soul. And we're required to interact in the physical world. We have to eat, we have to sleep, we have to have we have to have some form of income so we have a roof over our head. And as a result of this, we can sink down to this very mundane level where I said before, you become in this predictable downward spiral of not connecting to Hashem. And it literally, like he says, if the help necessary to continue on the path that you've chosen, if you've chosen this path of disconnection, of disobeying Hashem's will, then you will continue on that path until intervention happens. Like, you know, an object in motion will stay in motion, an object at rest will stay at rest until that's true, unless there's some kind of a force that acts upon it to stop it from its path. But that doesn't mean that hope is lost, and this is the Ramchal is trying to say, is that even for the person who's deviated from the proper way of serving Hashem, that they've deviated into this path, that there are forces, there are systems in this world that Hashem has placed out of love and mercy, which may not feel so kind and merciful at the time they're being, they take effect on our lives, but that the systems, the various systems of reward and punishment are there to get us to the point where we can connect to Hashem again, if we choose. Now, if we choose to disobey God, to continue on this pathway, then they will literally become the agents of our destruction. It's only when we make a conscious decision to turn towards God, to turn towards His will, and to place aside our own egos and serve Hashem the way that He requires, that we will be able to connect in the proper way. And all these things that have become agents of our punishment and of our destruction can now be transformed into holiness and blessings if we make that choice. So it's pretty amazing that we have that mankind, because of our ability to fall, we have the ability also to go to areas and realms where the angelic world could never touch. And by doing so, we can, because we have the spark of holiness, because we are conduits for God's light into this world, that we can bring Hashem's light into realms that are unimaginable for anyone else, that we can transform our world in ways that no other created being can. And so we sit in this very amazing place in creation, but we're also held accountable for it as well. That the life we're given, the time that we're able to interact in this world, that because of our awesome ability to affect the physical and the spiritual, and to be agents of such repair and good, that we stand before God accountable for how we use that in this world, and we will be accountable for what we did or didn't do. So we're getting into chapter 6, which is the system of providence here, and that starts on page 155. continue here. It says, God arranged matters so that his direction of the world should resemble that of an earthly government. This is true of everything in the world with respect to the judgment concerning man with his free will, as well as that which concerns the rest of the world and its creatures. Our sages thus teach, the kingdom of heaven resembles an earthly kingdom. The spiritual realm, therefore, contains courts of justice and deliberating bodies with an appropriate rules and procedures. God arranged these various tribunals consisting of spiritual beings in a particular system and level. All cases that are to be judged are brought before the courts, and what subsequently happens is a result of their decrees. It is thus written in Daniel 4:14, the matter is decreed by overseers. So you can see that wherever mankind goes, whether it be what we call technologically complex and civilization, or it be a very simple civilization, that unlike even the higher primates, we have systems of government, we have elders, we have overseers. Yeah, like the heavenly council, and that in the angelic realm, that you know, Hashem is of course at the top, but that there are levels in the angelic realm. That there are angels over angels over angels. So there is a system and an order, just like in a government. We have the federal government in the United States with, you know, Congress and these things, that the way that mankind has ordered his world is parallels that of the spiritual realm as well. So wherever you go, no matter how simplistic or complex a society may be, they mirror this principle of governing bodies over other individuals for the most part. So this is a principle that exists, I think, is in one of those attributes, those characteristics within mankind that mirrors our Creator. So continuing on, God manifests himself in all these deliberating bodies. He influences them and makes them grasp the essential nature of each case so that the judgment issued should be true. God himself leads some of these deliberating bodies. This is true in the case described of the prophet said, 1 Kings, I saw God sitting on his throne, and all the hosts of heaven stood to his right and to his left. Our sages explain that this is speaking of the heavenly tribunal, where those standing to the right represent the defense, while those standing to the left are the prosecution. Daniel likewise said, the thrones were placed and the Ancient of Days sat. The judgment was set and the books opened. The main reason for this is that every individual is judged with the utmost precision, as discussed earlier. Generally, when a person is judged on the whole as to what type of person he is, arguments can be put forth to judge him one particular way as opposed to all other ways for different reasons. The same is true regarding an individual person's individual deeds. A certain person's individual deeds. It might be possible to find fault with the deed from a certain perspective, but there often can be many other ways to view the deed as well. All this is so because matters of the world are complicated, interrelated to one another in different combinations with numerous consequences. In the heavenly courts of justice, all the truly relevant considerations for any matter are brought forward and revealed, each one to a member of the court who is particularly assigned to that aspect of the case, until the tribunal as a whole has the complete picture and nothing has been omitted. The case is then judged, each variable given its proper weight, so that the decision that is reached and the decree which is issued are always correct. The court's final ruling is issued by the head of a particular tribunal. If it is one of the courts which God himself desires to head, then he is the one who pronounces the final appropriate judgment. Even though everything is known beforehand to God, he still allows his servants, the hosts who stand before him, to argue the points of each case according to the truth that each one has ascertained. So you have these forces, you have these angelic realms, and each individual in how we interact with them, our actions affect these spiritual realms. And as a result, these agents that act in that spiritual realm will one day stand for us or against us. The idea in Judaism is that at a very low level, you're actually creating angels that will stand for you or against you in the day of judgment. That you're literally through physical actions influencing the spiritual realm in such a way that you're causing real spiritual forces to act in a certain way through your actions. And on the day of judgment, they will stand with you and against you in your defense or in your or accuse you. They're not necessarily the evil or I hate using the word evil or good. They're agents and agents of justice and judgment or mercy and kindness or a combination of the two, the perfect balance between the two. And so the ones on the left are the ones that are standing in judgment against you. They want to see God's strict justice metered out in your life without any temperance of mercy or forgiveness. Why? Because they're evil? Well, no, because that's why they were created. They were created to see God's justice, God's judgment. And then you have angels of mercy and agents of mercy, and that is their function and their role, to see that God's mercy, that His chesed, runs out in the world. Evil and good are literal, real concepts that exist in the physical world, but their reality is brought forth because of deficiency and God's light being withheld from creation. So evil is more a consequence than of deficiency and concealment of God's presence in the world, whereas good is a literal force that's being actively brought about by God. So when you do an action that causes good to increase, then you, by necessity, decrease the amount of evil and deficiency, allowing for God's light to enter into the world. And these are analogies that are used in Scripture as well, light and darkness, deficiency and holiness. So, whereas evil is this positive active force, I'm sorry, good is this positive active force, evil is more the consequence of when this force is withheld. Well, that's the point. How can God's light enter in creation when evil is overwhelmed? Well, that's one of the systems that Hashem has set into place, that there never ceases to be those individuals who are righteous, who are connected to God, and who allow for a certain amount of light to enter into creation. I'll let Marcia go.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt, but when you mentioned about the angels that are there that we create or we can create, I was thinking, I hope I can be heard, I was thinking there's a passage in the Torah and I can't find it. I think it's in Exodus. I'm trying to find it where it says that the Most High, there it is, I found it. In Exodus 23, verse 20, when the Most High sent Amalek, and it says, "And behold, I'm sending my messenger in front of you to keep you in the way, to bring you into the place which I've prepared. Attend to him and obey his voice. Do not rebel against him, for he will not forgive your transgressions." So when you mentioned that, I was thinking about, because someone's asking the question about, well, are they to do good or evil? And you explained that they're just there to do their mission. And so this is what reminded me of that passage, that this Malak or messenger was sent with the children of Israel, and he had strict instructions, and they were warned to be careful, do everything he says, because he won't forgive your transgression. So I hope that helped. Next on the mic.
I have a question about the what Marcia just said. Now, when you're having something like let's say in the time of Ahaz and Jezebel, and he wants to take the vineyard from Naboth, well, he's murdered, and all of the leaders go along with him, and then go into the court and say he was, I forgot what they said. Anyway, the point is that you had all of this evil, so. How would Amalek, what would be the circumstances of besides that time in Exodus? I mean, could we? Is there something we could do to have Amalek sent? I'm going to release the mic.
Well, that gets into this area of when God chooses to intervene through sending out in the angelic realm or activating the forces, which would be at the levels of like what we call archangels, that is to the discretion of Hashem. Those people who try to interact within the angelic realm, who try to interact directly with the angels rather than their creator, that is what you call sorcery and witchcraft. And you have that's what that is not connecting to our creator, but correcting to the forces, to the external things, to the system rather than the programmer. Yeah, it's not, you know, angels of the Most High, yeah. Shalom Alechem Ma'alchei HaShalom. Yeah, it's angels of the Most High coming down from the King of Kings. I know a lot of the prayers that involve angels are beseeching God directly. I'd have to look up that. I know there's a Psalms. Is it Psalm 90? Is it Psalm 91? Or I'll let you go. Okay, well, yeah, I mean, you can absolutely disagree. There are times, but it's never, you're never going and saying, you know, I want this angel to come to me. It's beseeching God to send to you the proper help at the proper time, rather than interacting with the forces directly. Now, you see in Scripture, you do see the, you know, individuals interacting with the angelic realm, but the idea of circumventing Hashem and trying to interact directly at the level of the angels is a very dangerous and precarious place. And the Psalm, I think it's Psalm 91, that talks about, you know, and there's this on Shabbat where you sing Shalom Aleichem, and it's beseeching God to send these angels on your behalf, not that you're calling out to a specific angel, a specific name, or a specific force. That's forbidden. That's sorcery. I didn't mean to imply that's what you're saying. But when you look at the interaction, when the, you know, like, you have Daniel, and you have, I'm trying to remember, my brain's drawing a blank. You have different individuals in Scripture that are interacting in the angelic realm. They're not seeking out specific angels. I'll let you go. Go ahead. Yeah, Jacob is a primary one. Who, let me give up the mic and I'll...
Okay, I want to tell you the prayer I said. I hope it's not it's not sorcery. I'll stop it right away if it is. But I'll say Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I ask that you surround, protect me, keep me safe from all harm or evil, and that you send your guardian angels. Send your angels, Michael, Gabriel, Raphael, and Uriel. And that's the prayer I've been saying. So I hope that's not sorcery.
Did you want to try again, Adam, to go? But I'm trying to say is there's a huge, and again, this is where intent is primary and very important, is there is the idea where people try to pray to angels. There are groups of individuals who, you know, who pray to the angels, and it's, you don't pray to the angelic realm. I'm sorry for misunderstanding the question, but that is forbidden. It's sorcery. It's connecting at the wrong place. But like Adam said, it's beseeching God to send his angels is a very different case. You know, asking him for specific actions is not forbidden. You know, there are times when you want all of the forces you can get and muster at the time. And there are prayers in Judaism that ask for these protecting angels, and that, like Shalom Aleichem, which I said Erev Shabbat. So, and that is literally beseeching God to send these angels of blessing and protection for you, and calling out to God to send emissaries on your behalf. Jacob did that. He divided his camp when Esau was coming for him, but he also prayed to God for assistance. So both is good, and there are and that is right in kosher. So, but the idea, and again, it is, it's people, I mean, idolatry is trying to connect to ways, connect to the external attributes of God rather than to God himself. And, yeah, well, but there is also, again, in the idea of asking for assistance from, for Hashem, you know, like, remember, you know, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, remembering these promises that, that you gave to them, and you see prayers in that regards too, where God recalls specific individuals on behalf of Israel. You know, sometimes God intervened on Israel's behalf, not because of their, because of them, but because of the promises and the merit of others. So the idea of calling upon that merit in regards to Hashem, beseeching Hashem for her, for help, is something that's done within Judaism as well. It's not, you're not praying to that individual. You're praying, you know, on behalf, like, on behalf of what they did, you know. Like, there are righteous individuals, like the Ramchal, he's awakened within me personally this amazing understanding and love and fire for Hashem that he didn't have before. And so, you know, it's in his merit that this happened because of the actions that he did when he wrote this book. It caused me to feel a certain way. So, knowing that there are righteous individuals who do awaken this connectivity to God within yourself, and that's why they were here, and their actions, and doesn't, just because they're not physically in the world, the actions of the Zadig don't cease just because they die. The writings of the Ramchal didn't just pass away because he died. They still exist, so he still has, exerts an influence in this world. And spiritually speaking, that these really high level of the Zadig that the Ramchal talks about in earlier chapters is because our soul and our true essence extends, is based in the spiritual world, that our influence and our connectivity and our reality doesn't cease because we're born at a specific time and we die at a specific time. Doesn't mean our influence on creation necessarily ends. But in the, our ability to interact in the physical world may be cut off with our death, but this, but the truth of the matter is that we're still spiritual beings. We don't cease to exist because our physical bodies die. So, when you have these righteous individuals who are able to create this level of connectivity not only in themselves but in others, then their influence doesn't pass away simply because their physical existence in this world was cut off with their death. And so you see the Ramchal saying, let me see here if I can find it. He says here on page 123, is in addition, there's a special higher type of suffering that comes to a Zadik, and who is even greater and more highly perfected than the ones discussed above. He talked about these righteous individuals who are able to affect their generation. So this suffering that they endure within their own lifetime isn't cut off just because they die. This suffering comes to provide the help necessary to bring about the chain of events leading to the ultimate perfection of mankind as a whole. That the work that they do in this physical world doesn't just end because they die. That this really highly perfected soul, this righteous individual, this Zadik, his actions, his works don't cease when he dies because of the level of connectivity, because the level of the, I guess basically the energies and the motion and the actions that he caused to be put into place, that his power is so great, his works and his connectivity to God so at such a high level that they continue to act even upon his death. An example. Moshe would be a great example. And so, not only the words, Abraham is the primary example of his actions and his faith. He literally changed the status of his descendants for all eternity, that the level at which he was able to connect to God at the time that he lived was able to benefit all of his future generations. So, I don't know if any other questions. But, like idolatry in the ancient realm was really literally trying to connect to gods, like the ancient, they weren't stupid. I mean, they had these idols and they would bring food to them somebody would have to either remove the food or it would rot and stink. They didn't physically eat, they didn't physically partake of these, but it's the idea is that using the physical world to connect to these idols by offering up their spiritual essence was a really important concept in the ancient realm. And so you have various methods that God has prescribed for us to connect to Him as well. And there are ways that we aren't to connect, meaning praying to specific angels, imploring specific powers, even looking at different aspects of God and trying to isolate them can be idolatry. Or like, you know, Saul going to Shmuel and conjuring up his soul. There are incorrect ways to try and connect to those forces in that angelic and spiritual realm that have really serious consequences. So, any other questions or comments?
What did you say about, now, you said that Sadiq, for instance, he does all kinds of things, works or things on the earth, and let's take Yeshua for an example, miracles or healings and all kinds of things. So what did you say about their spirit? I mean, that they leave the world, but their works go on and that sort of thing. I mean, could you kind of elaborate on that a little bit?
In regards to the physical world, when we our ability for our soul to live in, to influence the physical world is the vehicle through which our soul is able to do that is through our bodies. Now, when our bodies are cut off, then our ability to affect and influence the physical world directly is cut off as well. And so our conscious directed involvement in this world ceased to exist. That being said, the works that we do in this world, the good works or the bad, live on. They carry on. And as a result of that, because the true reality is that this physical world with its time and space is a temporary state of existence brought upon us by the fall of Adam and Eve, and that our perspective of a beginning and an end aren't necessarily the true reality, that our souls don't cease to exist with our death and they weren't created necessarily when we were born, that we also live in this realm of the spiritual where time and space as we understand them don't exist. And so the works that we do in the physical world continue on. So there is a time and a place where we are judged for our works, and there is a point where for which we are. Let me see if I can find a book that describes it a little bit better. But that here, let me see if I can find it. It was very eloquently written in this other book that I've been reading from. Like I can't find. Let me see if I can do it justice and try it while I'm trying to look. Talks about this, like in Israel, using Israel as an example. Israel was you have Jacob and his descendants going to the land of Egypt, and then his descendants fall into this state of basically exile from their purpose. They become slaves. They become mired down in Egypt, and God has to specifically intervene on their behalf to bring them out. Now, at the state He finds them when He begins this redemption process, they aren't necessarily wholly set apart and connected to God in a very high way. But at one point, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and his descendants were. Now, for Israel, if you look at that point in time, then Israel wasn't necessarily worthy of the redemption that they received. But transcending time, you have you have the promises to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You have the works that they did, these good works, which transcend the boundaries of their own life and are able to influence God to act in a specific way at a different point in time. In the spiritual realm, these actions didn't pass this spiritual energy that was created by Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob didn't cease because they died. It continued to have an effect on future generations. And that's the idea of the roots. The spiritual roots of these nations don't cease just because their forebears died, that they continue to interact upon their descendants in such a way that they bring about series of events in the physical world. And so certain souls, based upon from which spiritual root they come from, have attributes and characteristics. You know, if you look at genetics, you have the Habsburgs that became this really, you know, you can look at the paintings because of all the interbreeding that the family did over the generations. Like, that's a Habsburg. They had the lip, the nose thing. Same is true, yeah, strange-looking people if you're familiar with them. But genetically, it's the best concept that I can come up with to explain this idea of attributes having an effect on the descendants. So Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob not only had attributes that they gave to their descendants, but they also created spiritual energy. We all do, and it follows us into the spiritual realm. And when we're judged, the energy, the actions, the works that we did or did not do, they still exist. They don't cease. And so that is what we have when we take with us to when we stand before Hashem in judgment. And sometimes, like the level of the Tzaddik, that their actions, the sufferings that they endure, don't just affect their generation, meaning they don't just affect this one period in time in which they lived, but that transcends time and space and is able to affect future generations all the way from the first person to the last person, because in the spiritual realm, that concept is not a reality. And so, the best of my ability in trying to explain some of these concepts without skipping too far ahead or going back. I don't know if that was helpful at all. I'm trying to find the specific spot that I was trying. I can't find it right offhand. So in regards to the Tzaddik, in the Ramchal says in an earlier portion, which is page 123, that the suffering that this person undergoes, and they undergo this specific suffering at a specific time and place, transcends their own lifetime in this physical realm and is able to affect everything. He even says, here if I can find it. Here it says here on page 125, it says, beyond that, the merit and power of these Tzaddikim, it's also increased because of such suffering. This gives them even greater ability to rectify the damage of others. They can therefore not only rectify their own generation, but can also correct all the spiritual damage done from the beginning, from the time of the very first sinners. So you have these individuals because of their level of connectivity, that they're physical, they're able to transcend time through their own connection to God, and they're able to influence individuals outside of their own lifetime. Almost like spiritual time travel. I don't know if any questions. I'll leave the mic open for questions or comments, and I'll.
I don't think it's. I don't understand that. I don't think it's time travel per se by the person, but the effects of their actions can transverse time. Is that what you? Oh, you was just kidding. Okay. All right. Hey, I'm serious here. We're listening, girl. We're listening.
I'm going to read a little bit in this, and it's not the Ramchal, and I don't generally do this, but it just describes some of the concepts so well that I think it's important, especially when coming into the roots and branches and his discussion about Israel and the nations. I'll read a little bit. See here. Every transgression damages a soul because each command corresponds to a particular limb. Each transgression damages that limb and the corresponding part of the soul. So he's saying that our soul, different commandments attach to different aspects and reality of our of what comprises our soul. And it not only damages the corresponding limbs, but its roots in the upper sphere. Just like a diseased branch can actually kill a whole tree. It can spread throughout the tree to the very root and kill the tree. This is true of us. As individuals, we're attached to a tree and ultimately to our spiritual root. So the transgression not only damages the soul and the body, but also the root of the soul in the upper realms. The transgression changes the system of worlds from the greatest heights to the lowest depths. The nature and force of that change depend on the character of the transgression. So it's a really important concept that our actions not only affect our own particular branch on which we exist, but they also can affect the whole tree. So we have, like the Ramchal stated in previous chapters, various purifying processes and retributions in the spiritual realm or in the world or in this world as appropriate retribution for each of our transgressions and sins in order to cleanse and remove the stain and the blemish. I'm going to skip ahead here. If I can skip ahead here in 25, I'm trying to find the point where he says, okay, so he says that what happens is when we connect to God at some point, when we make a conscious decision to connect to our Creator, to serve Him, that we exchange something, that there's a kernel of basically this holy spark that's placed within our soul that's awakened, and it's a gift from God that is placed within our soul. And we all have this potential within ourselves to do that. All of humanity has this potential to connect to God above and beyond the general level in a very specific way. And that awakening comes from above. And how we respond determines our future status, basically. That you have this ability when you are awakened by God, when you have this connection, we have this moment where you see and perceive God in a way above and beyond the general rules of nature and the life that you live, and you're able to connect, that you exchange something. And he places this holy spark within your soul that even if you should fall away at that moment in time, you had this connection that transcends physical world, that transcends time. And even if you fall away and you go into a state of exile, that you have this holy spark within you that through Hashem's mercy doesn't pass away, doesn't get extinguished. And if the circumstances in your life allow for another awakening, that this, it's like a holy magnet to the divine, stronger than this general revelation that exists within all of us. It's a very specific draw that Hashem has placed within you. So you may fall away, you may turn to sin, you may fall into the filth and physicality and desires of the physical world, and cease to connect with God. And they talk about in this book, it's a commentary on a book called the Tanya. He talks about sins. There's sins that even required that they're called spiritual death. They're called karet, that literally cut your soul off. You unplug from your source. But even those sins, even if you've gone that far, in this moment can be forgiven. Says in the final analysis, no sin precludes the possibility of repentance. So it makes no difference whether a person decides to violate a seemingly minor enactment or to worship an idol. He might conclude that in either case he will not suffer complete and absolute disconnection from the divine, even if he decides from the outset to sin with the intention to repent afterwards. But in the final analysis, he says the final analysis, I'm sorry, let me get here. In the final analysis, what will happen if you choose to, and you can even extinguish that spark that God's placed within you to come back to Him, that in the final analysis, that when there is a revelation of man's will versus God's will, then that innermost part of a person that seeks to cling to the innermost part of God can be awakened, and you can do this very powerful act called Teshuvah. And this is this divine spark that is placed within us that exists within, very hidden within the general world, within mankind. It's very hidden. But when you make that specific connection, it's I guess it's awakened, it's brought alive, that that this holy spark is transcends your physical being. It transcends time and space. It's connected to God at a very high level. And as a result of this connectivity, it's not you. It's the spark of Hashem within us that can awaken us all at once. And so the ability to awaken this aspect, to connect to God and to receive this holy spark, there are some individuals, they're called the Zadikim, they're called righteous individuals, that receive this connectivity that transcends, even in our own limited way, we can transcend time, meaning that we have a connection to God and we can fall away, yet in our own physical lifetime, we can turn back to God, and it's as though, you know, Hashem forgets our sins, and it's as though we hadn't fallen away at all. So we can transcend time in some respect in regards to our spiritual status before God, that we can fall away and we can do teshuvah, we can return. And the same is true regarding the Zadik, not that they would fall away, but that they're able to connect to God, that just as we're able to awaken this holy spark, that they create this spiritual energy that exists outside of themselves, it's connected directly to God, and they basically shovel a pathway that others can now follow to get to that level of connectivity that they had reached. And it's a poor analogy, but it's a hard concept to convey without finding the specific. And like I said, there's authors very, very, very eloquent and much more intelligent than I'll ever be that have stated this in a pretty profound way. And it's this idea that the Zadik and our connectivity we can transcend our own lifetime if we choose to. And also the converse is true, that in our own physical actions we can cause a great amount of evil that not only affects us in our own lifetime, but that can affect future generations as well. You talked about the ability to perceive God's light, for God's light to enter into the world and for us in return to perceive God's light. And so one of the methods through which the Zadik, the righteous individual, is able to do that is by revelation of God's will in our world. I'll let Watchful go. I'm sorry.
My question, Dennis Prager, yeah. I met him many years ago in California, and I know when he always said that about in the final analysis. That kind of stuck with me. My question is this now. Gosh, I hope I didn't forget it. Rolling off my brain like Teflon here. oh, brother, I think I just forgot what I wanted to say. I did. I guess I'm going to have to type it in when I remember it. That's okay. I'll type it in.
But one of the things they say, whether we're talking about the Zadikim or Teshuvah, or even if you look at different mechanisms in Torah, which are right now not accessible to us, other ways to connect to Hashem through sacrifices and through offerings and through the service of the temple, or specific times and places that were appointed to meet Hashem, which is a Pesach and Shavuot and all these other holidays and Shabbat. These are all mechanisms to gain connectivity, to gain understanding, to gain relationship with our Creator, and in turn the word sanctify, to change ourselves, to nullify ourselves and transform our life into such a way that we're able to become receptacles of God's love. That's the ultimate purpose for all of these systems, is that we can receive God's love in the way in which He desires to give it to us, in the most open, direct way possible for us as individuals, that we can become receptacles of Hashem's love. So these various systems of purification and purging and reward and punishment that draw us closer or purify us and remove blemishes are all there to make us worthy receptacles for Hashem to basically give us that greatest gift, which is Himself. And so at the heart of it, whether it's this general providence or these specific providence or all these concepts, to never lose, I guess when we talk about these ideas and these concepts, it's really easy, I know for myself, to get all wrapped up in the various commandments and the various principles and these different ideas and lose sight of the fact that we're here to connect. We're here to connect to each other. We're here to connect to God. We're here to make ourselves, like I said again, receptacles of the living God, to allow Him to give us His love, which is Himself. So I don't want to think that by getting involved in some of these, and we're really going to start getting involved in some, I guess, the nuances of these different principles that exist, to lose sight of that fact that these are here for only for the purpose to bestow good upon us. Well, using the word like protection, or you said the question is, if there's something wrong with us, could it be through the evil or something we are not doing, and there are protection, and there our protection field is down? Well, the idea is that the switch is either on or off. You're either connecting or disconnecting. And when you're in a state of disconnection, then you're vulnerable to deficiency, to you're in a state of vulnerability. Your attraction and your draw towards the physical world is greater when you're not consciously using the physical world for the service of Hashem. Then it can become a mechanism that draws you further and further away from the service of God. And so there are times when people disconnect and they become vulnerable to the effects of the physical world, that they go from a state of connectivity to the state of general rules of nature. And just like the person who, who eats a fatty diet, who has a genetic propensity towards, you know, high cholesterol, then they're going to develop they're going to probably develop some kind of a heart disease. Is it like a punishment? No, they fell into bad habits, and they have a genetic propensity, and they didn't modify their behavior, and therefore they suffer in the consequences of all these various circumstances. Now, had they exercised and taken medication and kept better track of their health and watched their diet, then maybe their circumstances would be different. But there's also the case of sometimes suffering comes to individuals not because of them, but because it's necessary for the whole grand scheme of thing. Remember, we are as individuals important to Hashem, but we're part of a whole as well. We're part of a community. We're part of humanity. And God's overarching principle is that while He cares about the individual, He is taking everyone. We're all on the same path. We're ultimately leading to the same point, and God is going to take us there. Now, what state you arrive in at that point is up to you, based upon your choices. But just because an individual suffers an illness or something bad doesn't necessarily mean it's because of them. Maybe there was a purpose and a reason that needed to be done, that energy needed to exist in the world. And the example I use is, you can't say, and Ramchal even says, that the various nuances of how God balances this all out, how the mechanisms and the millions of different circumstances that He causes to happen to bring about His ultimate will for creation is so above and beyond us that we can't necessarily look at an individual and say, oh, you're suffering because, you know, yesterday your grandmother called and you didn't give her a ride, and tomorrow, you know, now your car's broken down. You can't say that. You may be able to say, well, that might be a real contributing factor, but the point is all of that lies within the hands of God. So there are times that I wouldn't say a person is born to suffer, but that suffering, because of the reality of our world, suffering does exist, and suffering is a mechanism that God has used. It's one of the systems that God's placed in this world to bring about repair and healing and restoration. So that, does God cause someone to suffer specifically? Are they born just to suffer? I'd say it more like God uses the suffering in this world to bring about good, that there's no wasted energy in our world, that everything that happens in this world, ultimately, in the end, when all things are transformed, when the world is brought about to its true purpose, then all the evil in this world can be transformed into good. But it really is evil. It really is suffering. It really does hurt. It really does cause pain. It really has literal consequences in this world. But at the point when creation is brought to the place that it's supposed to be, then all the pains and sufferings and the evil of this world can be transformed in the greatest holiness possible. And so, yeah, it's not easy to feel happy about that because there really is good and evil in this world. It really does exist as separate concepts. And so it's, I guess it's a motivation that how much deficiency exists in the world has a direct impact on how much evil exists in this world, and how much evil and deficiency exists is based upon the actions of individuals. When we choose to serve Hashem, we become conduits for God's light in this world in our own way, in which God has allowed us, we can influence and open up creation to God's light, our own world. So, not to say that you as an individual are responsible for the world being an evil state, but you have a real direct impact upon the amount of evil that exists based upon your actions. It's a huge responsibility. Every individual has this very specific role that only you or I can fill. We're made specifically to fulfill a very important function, or else God wouldn't allow us to exist. And that's the function that only you can do. It's something only you can do. Only somebody with your weaknesses and strengths, your characteristics, and your propensities towards certain actions can fulfill. So, okay. Well, I'll open up the room for questions.
I just wanted to say something about the promise that I wrote in there. You know, he said that he wouldn't put any of these diseases on us that he had put on Egypt if we follow his Torah. And I kind of look at it like a parent, and a parent gives the child the rules. Okay, you follow the rules, and you're rewarded, or you don't follow the rules, and you are punished. And one of the benefits is that he says that he's our healer. And so, if he's going to give us something that we can't follow, or it's so difficult for us to follow, well, actually, we are living in Egypt. Yes, we are. It is in Egypt. Yes, it is. And the diseases, we live here and we are in diseases. If you look at the things like diabetes or heart disease and all these things, it's not just about, most of our food is no good anyway. Well, that is a disease. And they do, our food, water, air, the earth has been polluted. I mean, we know this. And, if people use the microwave, they kill the food there anyway. Well, I'm not going to go with you there, Taz. The thing is that in following Torah, then we should, and he's our healer, we should be healed from these things as we try to, we're eating kosher, we do that, but even everything in this world, in this physical world, it affects us, it does. I mean, so I guess that's the point, if you're following Torah, and I don't believe that you have to be exotic for this to happen. If that's the case, then, well, I guess 99.9% of us are out the window there. We're trying to do the best that we can. But what I was saying before, like you have the pharmacies that put out the medicines. I mean, if anybody watches television at all, you look on the, you see that the advertisements, and they talk about this medicine and everything it can cause, the problems it can cause you, even death, the food and the chemtrails, it's just all kinds of things. Okay, so we know that these do have effect on us, And so, how can he become our healer then? What is it that we have to do? You know, what is it we exactly have to do? I'm going to release the mic.
Well, I would say two things. One, that the commandments, while they may have some physical benefits, there may be some physical benefits to eating kosher. There may be some agricultural benefits to following the rules of the land, following this cycle of the Shemitah. That's not the primary reason that they exist. And our comfort, our joy, our pleasure, our physical health may not necessarily be the primary state for us to exist in this physical world to do what we need to do. So not everyone is going to function as, you know, we're not all super intelligent or super beautiful or super athletes. We all have talents and abilities, and there are some people who are not meant to be healthy, vibrant individuals that is the function that they fulfill. That being said, you shouldn't seek to be well, shouldn't seek to be healthy, you shouldn't pray for healing, those type of things. That's not true at all. But there are specific circumstances that are unique to every individual, and the circumstances that they find themselves in, they should absolutely seek Hashem to understand why they are there. But using those circumstances and knowing that the suffering that an individual faces in this world is not a wasted energy, that the end, all of the sufferings and travails of this world are meaningless in the fact that they are transformed into, they can be through our actions and through serving Hashem, be transformed into absolute holy gifts. But that only comes as if you keep your true perspective of why you exist here. It's not to be comfortable, rich, or happy. It's to serve your Creator with everything in every circumstance and in all times. And it may be that you're poor, and that's what you're meant to be. So that's just the reality of the world. Now, that being said, should you not seek to change your circumstances? That's not true. I'm going to read this one section and close it off, and then we can have just a general discussion. So this is, I found the section I was trying to find. This is again a reading from the Tanya book, but in previous chapters, this author discussed two aspects of the commandments. It says, attachment to the divine, the result of performing the positive commandments. So when we do what God says to do, then we are able to attached to Hashem, and severance of this from the divine as a result of violating the prohibitions in the Torah. Both aspects essentially express the same idea, that the commandments are not only details and their observance is not merely a question of good deeds or bad deeds. Rather, they embody our entire relationship with God. Are we here? Are we for Him or are we against Him? When a person performs a mitzvah, a command, he is united with God. If he commits a sin, he cuts himself off from God, rebels against Him, disparages His name. Deciding whether to perform a commandment or commit a sin constitutes the foundation of our lives. When one performs a commandment, he does more than identify with just one instance of the expression of God's divine will. Rather, he unites directly with the divine being. And if a sin is committed, a person not only transgresses one clause or another, he is disloyal to the King of Kings, the Holy One, blessed be He. Therefore, the choice between commandment and sin is as stark a decision as whether or not to give one's life in order to sanctify God's name. Remember, he said earlier in a previous chapter, who is a true Jew is one who is willing to lay down his life, figuratively and literally, to keep that connection with Hashem going. That the connectivity, the relationship with our Creator is more important than anything in this world, that any pleasure, any reward that we could possibly receive in this world is meaningless, is just trash before this connection if it causes us to lose that. So thousands of years of Jewish history and thousands of terrible trials have taught us that when a Jew is faced with this existential question, are you for or against God? Do you desire to cleave to God or are you prepared to be severed from Him? That the true Jew, clearly, he will choose God no matter what the cost. The Jew will not allow anything to remove him from God, even if he will be killed as a result. His decision is not subject to a discussion, nor is it amenable to any reconsideration. And that's the whole point of Hanukkah. In these chapters, the author adds that when one is confronted with this fundamental choice in full force, not only in extreme life and death situations, accept idolatry or die, but when the alternatives are seemingly inconsequential and less clear-cut. For instance, when faced with the dilemma whether to perform a minor positive commandment or forego it to gain some health benefit, or when faced with the temptation to engage in some lesser sin, promising oneself that he'll afterward repent. This, he says, the author concludes that in all of these choices, the question at hand is essentially the same. He said, no matter how great or how small, the struggle is always whether or not to sanctify God's name, meaning drawing ourselves closer to God. And when a person is aware of this, his decision will always be the same. He is prepared to live in a self-sacrificing way in order to keep this connection to God, to sanctify God's name. And he is not just willing to die for this end, but is willing to, let's say, is not just willing to die for this end. So, I'll leave it at that, and saying that this is all about this connection here. So again, that will be continuing on in section 6, I believe. Yeah, section 6, System of Providence. In section 3 and 157. So again, thank you very much for coming. It's been a tremendous blessing. Any questions or comments?
First, can I be heard? Does my sound work now? One. Thank you. You're talking about the watch ones or the watchers and that. In old Hebrew writings, they had a lot of references to some called the heavenly council, that which God uses to rule the world or to do His will. And I think what you're alluding to in this book tonight was probably that council or that ruling body. I noticed that in the last 3,000 years or so, there hasn't been too much writings or information about this council. And I just kind of thought that it caught my attention. Anyhow, just a thought. It was too quiet. I had to say something and test my sound. Mic is free.
Okay. I don't know if you can hear me. One of it's one of the interpretations of Genesis 1:26, and it says, and God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness. They shall rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, and over the animal, the whole earth, everything creeping that creeps on the earth." So the commentary is in Targum Jonathan paraphrases, "And God said to the ministering angels who had been created on the second day of creation of the world, 'Let us make man.'" So one of the ideas is that he's consulting the heavenly council in regards to the creation of mankind. So that was one of the possible interpretations, though not the only one, in what it means when it says, "Let us make man in our image after our likeness."
Yeah, most of the writings concerned are very, very old. I read someplace at one time or other that the number on the council are 70 positions. And then I read that Lucifer's position was number 60. His seat was number 60 on that council. And I was given the impression that he is still on that seat until he is forcibly removed from the heavenlies. But that's just my impression. Anyhow, mic is free. Yes, I agree. And like I said, he's still on that seat and still has that part. But it does say that he will be forcibly removed. What is the name of this text? It's just some reading that I have so many readings over the years. I wish I could give you the source and the reference on that article. Generally, what happens is because the writings are so old, you read several different articles and you come out of it with an understanding. of some sort. So that's why I'm being so vague about what I'm saying. It is said, and or I believe, or this is what has been stated. It's not scripture, in other words. But just trying to answer your question. Mic is free. I have gone back to the beginning of this book and started to slowly read it again, just to see if there's any other understanding that I overlooked. And I am enjoying what I find immensely. It's a difficult book in itself, but going over it is, I find, very helpful. Just a comment. Any suggestion? Mic is free. We say in our Jewish prayers that God is one. And reading this book, especially from the beginning, I'm beginning to have a different understanding of that concept. God is one. I don't think it's what the average person would realize what it really means, that God is one. For instance, some say that one means, well, he's the top of the hill, the king of the mount is number one that way. Then others say he is number one in person. He's a person. Well, he's not a person, but that's what how they say it. He is one person. And in fact, that's one of the biggest problems that the Jews have with some of us. They say that we have made him more than one person. I don't think that's the right concept. Understanding us as human beings, we are compartmentized, segmented, different parts of us. We see with one part, read with one part, understand with one part, and so forth. For God is one. He sees everything. He has everything in one part. He is not, he is simple, if you will, as this author seems to be saying. He is so simple that everything of him is one. It is not compartmentized like you and I are. That's what I'm beginning to understand about God is one. Am I on the right track, do you think? Or should I go back and read it over again? Just a question. Mic is free.
The understanding that I glean from the various writings is that in Hashem's essence there is no... Well, first of all, Hashem's true essence, there is absolute no discerning and no understanding. That's the concept of the Ein Sof. But then you have this point of contraction, this point of entry into the physical world, which is its essence, a complete oneness. There's no compartments. But from our perspective, and because of our limitations and our inability to perceive all things and together, that we have to compartmentalize God, that we have to see different attributes, different aspects of God. And so from our perspective, Hashem is not one and his name is not one in this physical world, because the world is deficient and because of sin, that this oneness of Hashem was fractured, was smashed with the fall of Adam and Eve. And so we have a perception of God that is compartmentalized, unfortunately. And so we aren't able to perceive God at that higher level that even Adam and Eve were able to perceive God.
Okay, so what you're saying is that because of our fallen state, we cannot hope to understand or have an idea or perceive what God really is. So we just try to make do with our limited abilities. The problem I see with our limited abilities in make and do is it causes much strife among ourselves and much hate, if you will. Isn't that surprising? Mic is free.
Well, the concept of it's in scripture. Well, It's in Scripture. It's when Moshe failed to speak to the rock rather than to strike it. It's a really important concept called sanctification of the name. And Hashem says, because you failed to sanctify my name, Moshe, you're going to get this punishment. And the idea is that through our turning to Hashem and serving Him by doing what He requires of us and avoiding those things which He said are prohibited, that we bring a unity, that those holy sparks that brought creation into existence were fractured. There's this explosion of this unity that existed and this perfect balance and symmetry that existed within the Garden of Eden. And when Adam and Eve fractured that unity, these holy sparks became scattered throughout all levels of creation. It's like a giant puzzle waiting to be put together. And so through our actions, we're able to gather these holy sparks where they've fallen and piece them back into their proper place. So when we do actions by fulfilling God's will, by, like I said, doing what He requires and avoiding those things which are prohibited and doing them with the proper intent, then we're able to bring, to elevate these sparks that have fallen and put them in the proper place. And so what happens is when people fail to do that, then you bring about greater disunity. You fracture and scatter the sparks even more than they were before. And so that's why Scripture says at the point in time, which is not a reality now, in that day Hashem's name will be one. Meaning that now in this world, that the name of Hashem, meaning His attributes, are scattered, they're fractured, they're disjointed, there's not real unity because of the nature of our world, that they will be brought together again at some point in the future. And that the idea of tikkun, the idea of repair, is not, you know, you're not physically repairing the physical world, that you're gathering these sparks and bringing and elevating them, cleaning them off, like looking for diamonds. It's a muddy, nasty, disgusting process, but when you find them, you clean them and you polish them and you're able to bring them to a state where they weren't before. And the same type of concept exists regarding these holy sparks of creation that are hidden. And through our actions, through turning to Hashem, we're able to dig them out of the mud and the muck and the mire and polish them and make them acceptable and bring them back to their true state. And so that's what the unification of God's name means, that our actions either bring about deficiency and greater disunity, or they bring about light and greater repair.
I'm going to repeat my question here. So you're suggesting that somehow, some way, somebody or a group will sometime be able to bring these sparks back together? Is that what you're postulating? Am I hearing you correctly, or am I understanding correctly? Am I hearing what you're saying is my question. Mic is free.
I guess you could say that we're all responsible for that. Israel was responsible for that specifically. We're all as individuals responsible for that. But from the broad base, from like general speaking, in the individual's own responsibility in that role, that there are sparks of holiness that are within our bounds to elevate. Now, whether we do that or not is up to us. That's the actions that we're able to fulfill. But ultimately, Israel was set with the mission to do this. And when they fail, then there's another fail-safe mechanism in creation called the Mashiach, the Messiah, and that's the role of Mashiach in our world, is to bring about this unification of God's name, and it's bring about the elevation of mankind to its proper status. I'd say one of the greatest examples of this concept is Isaiah 53. I've heard so many discussions and debates about Isaiah 53. Oh, it's only the nation of Israel. No, it has to be about the Messiah. It can't be about Israel. But the idea is Israel's role, Israel's function is basically the function of Mashiach, to bring about this unity, to bring about repair and restoration. And when Israel is unable to do this, then Hashem has set up another mechanism called the Mashiach. And so the question is was Israel made to fail so the Mashiach could do that, or is the Mashiach just another system if Israel can't do the mission that they're supposed to do. And I think both Israel can still function at that level, maybe at a lower level, and not fulfilling its mission completely. And that's why the Mashiach is necessary. So a verse like Isaiah 53 and the great debate that revolves around it is just it's a moot point, because it's true. It is about Israel, and it is about the Mashiach, because they have, in many ways, the same function, the same role, and the same purpose for existence. Now, when one fails, the other will pick up the slack, and we know that Israel is the one who fails, and the Mashiach is the one who comes and takes the slack up. But that doesn't excuse Israel from its mission in the world. And if you look, you see that the restoration that occurs is Israel is repaired and brought back to their proper status. And when they do, when they're restored through Mashiach and brought and elevated to their proper place, then because they fell, they're able to, we talked about the exile and that fallen status, they're able to go to the lowest levels of creation and find these sparks and reach these sparks that would have been lost had they never fallen in the first place. So through Israel's fall, a greater portion of creation is repaired and restored along with them. Like the boat rising, they all rise together. And so Israel is able to redeem these holy sparks from these very hidden and the lowest levels of creation possible. And so is the Mashiach. So I think there's definitely a parallel. And so you have a lot of these false arguments, especially Isaiah 53 is one I think is the biggest one about, you know, it can't be both at the same time.
From what I've seen of our people, I don't hold up much hope that we as a nation, or a group of people, if you will, however you want to look at Israel, can hope to accomplish that plan of Isaiah 53. Not saying that it won't happen, I just don't have much. I don't know what, enthusiasm? Hope? Maybe I'd have to take a wait and see attitude. But I know there are different levels of interpreting most of the scriptures, and you are postulating two of them right there on that one verse. And I accept that. But still, I have to think on that, because I never thought of it in the context of what you said. As always have been so far, either or. So I'll do some thinking on it, and I thank you for that.
Let me read this portion. This is Isaiah 49, starting in 14. It says, can a woman forget her nursing child and not have compassion on the son of her womb? Surely they may forget, yet I will not forget you. See, I have inscribed on you the palms of my hands. Your walls are continually before me. Your sons shall make haste, and your destroyers who laid you waste shall go away from you. Lift up your eyes, look around and see. All these gather together and come to you. As I live, says the Lord, you shall surely clothe yourselves with them as an ornament and bind them on you as a bride does. For your waste and desolate places and the land of your destruction will even now be too small for the inhabitants, and those who swallowed you will be far. A key verse here. The children you will have after you have lost the others will say again in your ears, this place is too small for me. Give me a place where I may dwell. Then you will say in your heart, who has begotten these for me since I have been lost, my children, since I have lost my children and am desolate, a captive wandering to and fro? And who has brought these up? There I was left alone, but these, where were they? Thus says the Lord God, behold, I will lift my hand in an oath to the nations, and I will lift, and I will set up my standard for the peoples. They shall bring your sons in your arms, and your daughters shall be carried on their shoulders. Kings shall be your foster fathers, and queens your nursing mothers. They shall bow down to you and lick their faces to the earth, and lick up the dust of your feet. And you will know that I am the Lord your God, for they shall not be ashamed who wait for me. So he talks about here that when Israel has fallen away, that what Israel lost is made up beyond imagination in what they're able to bring back. When Israel rises back up through Hashem's mercy, that basically the children you'll have if the others are lost will be, the place of your habitation will be too small, meaning that you can look at them as literal people, or you can look at them as the works, these holy sparks that they're able to gather from these places where they never would have been before because they fell to such low extremes. And that book that I absolutely love, that Adin Steinfeld talks about the whole purpose of exile when Israel was brought to this really low place, and they came out not just with themselves, they came out with souls, they came out with gold, they came out with all the riches. They basically, you know, came out with all the riches and the wealth of Egypt, and they were able to do that. Had they stayed in the land, they would not have been able to redeem those elements from Israel, I mean from Egypt. And it was those elements out of this really, you know, this bastion of idolatry and darkness and magic and idolatry and sorcery that they took these elements and they transformed into the Mishkan, into the tabernacle in the wilderness. They took the gold that was used in idolatry in Egypt and they made it into the holy implements and of the tabernacle. So it's this amazing transformation and ability to take these really fallen objects and elevate them in a very high way. And by doing so, they're able to, I hate the word flip, but to change, to affect the spiritual forces behind them. Because we know that gold and silver and all these elements are connected. And there's a really important concept that's taught that man's attachment to base elements in creation, like gold, is really, you know, irrational. When you look at, especially ancient man, where, you know, you were one crop failure away from death, why were they chasing after gold and things that were inedible? Wouldn't you be chasing after, you know, not just rich farmland, but people's stocks of food? And you look at all the wealth and the treasures that were looted. What's the purpose? What's the attraction? And they say it transcends, you know, rational thinking, and it goes to their level of attachment to God in the spiritual realm. And so, these objects were used where they cleansed. I mean, there were processes that like when they went into the land and they conquered the land, there was different things. Like if it was metal or if it was, you know, clay, there are different ways to deal with different elements of these, the booty, the rewards and the plunder of warfare. Some of the things had to be destroyed. And there were some towns where they couldn't take anything. So you can see the level of spiritual contamination that existed within them. But these objects are basically stripped from Egypt and brought into Israel, and a lot of these, the prizes that they get from the Egyptians are transformed into the elements of the Mishkan. And so you see that had they, these spiritual forces and these, behind these elements, these base elements of gold and silver and linen and wool and all these spiritual elements that caused these items to exist, would have been lost in the idolatry of Egypt, but now they're transformed and they're placed in the camp in the basket of Israel. And so I don't know if maybe going through that that whole process of redemption, that they were cleansed in a way such as the people were. Because there's the Midrash that a majority of the people of Israel died in the land of Mitzrayim. They died in the land of Egypt. That some of the teachings even say upwards of 80% of the people died during the plague of darkness and didn't even make it to the redemption because their souls had fallen so much that even the spark of holiness had been extinguished by themselves. So that even that spark of holiness, that little ember that God placed within their souls had been extinguished by their own actions, that they weren't able to be awakened and brought out of Egypt. To steal a line from the Matrix, they had become so dependent on the source that they were no longer, they became protectors of the very system that had kept them trapped.